So the majority of patients with Sjögren's syndrome have dryness of their eyes and dryness of their mouth. Now, that is a fairly common set of symptoms that patients who are perfectly healthy may experience from time to time. But what's so different about patients with Sjögren's syndrome is that these symptoms are there every day, and they're quite disabling. So the dryness of the eyes limits their ability to work at a computer. It leads to a constant sensation of sand or grit in their eyes. It may blur their vision. And so this kind of daily persistent dryness of the eyes is what's so characteristic, and they have to use drops, artificial tears, 3 or 4 times a day to gain relief. And similarly for the dryness of the mouth, it's a daily persistent symptom that interferes with their ability to eat. They often have to sip water to chew and swallow something dry. They may get burning in their throat from the dryness. They're very much at risk of developing dental caries. So it's a very different dryness than you and I experience when we're a bit nervous or been working out all day and haven't had much water. But this is a daily persistent symptom. And not only the dryness, but patients with Sjögren's syndrome have a lot of other symptoms which are very disturbing. The majority of patients report that they have joint pain and stiffness. They have brain fog. They have this fatigue that's incapacitating. These are things that they report and are very disabling in terms of their daily lives. Now, in addition to the dryness of the eyes and mouth, Sjögren's syndrome can affect other organ systems, such as the kidneys, the blood vessels leading to something called vasculitis, the lungs, nervous system leading to peripheral neuropathy. And these are much more serious complications, and fortunately, they arise in a very small minority of patients with Sjögren's syndrome. Probably no more than 20% will have this more serious internal organ involvement. There's another complication which is more concerning, which is the development of lymphoma. It occurs in about 5 or 10% of patients with Sjögren's who are followed for a long period of time. Fortunately, the lymphomas are most often a very indolent, low-grade form, which sometimes actually does not require specific treatment. It can be watched over time without treatment. But that is something that we watch out for very carefully, the development of lymphoma in patients who have Sjögren's syndrome. So about 20% of patients with Sjögren's syndrome can develop what we call a peripheral neuropathy, which is injury to the nerve fibers that are present in the skin and in the limbs. And this can lead to a variety of symptoms, but most commonly to a burning pain or numbness, less commonly to some motor weakness. We recognize that this occurs as a complication of Sjögren's and may require specific treatment.